Hello, welcome to Builder Event. I'm a professional, paid Hogwarts expert, and today I'm going to be reacting to the depiction of Hogwarts we see in Fantastic Beasts, The Secrets of Dumbledore. I will also be addressing a massive mistake they made in the marketing campaign, and talking about why I personally don't like the version of the castle we see in Fantastic Beasts. So let's get into it. So from Hogwarts' point of view, Fantastic Beasts has been using the Deathly Hallows version of the castle. Now, if you don't know, Hogwarts goes through a lot of changes in the films, which I've detailed in a previous video, which you can check out somewhere. And in each film, kind of more stuff got added to it until Deathly Hallows, where the version of the castle we see in Deathly Hallows is actually quite different to the version we got in Philosopher's Stone. And there are a couple of key features that are immediately noticeable in Fantastic Beasts for pinpoint that this is the Deathly Hallows version of the castle. And the main one is the viaduct, because in Deathly Hallows the viaduct was in a completely different position to all of the rest of the films. Now in Deathly Hallows the viaduct connects the castle to a random hill. In the previous films the viaduct is connecting two internal parts of the castle. So this is kind of annoying because Fantastic Beasts is obviously a prequel to the Harry Potter series, so in my mind I feel like they should be using the version of the castle from Philosopher's Stone. However, I think the reason they use the Deathly Hallows version is because throughout films 1 to 6, they were using a physical model of Hogwarts, which is on display at the studio tour in the UK. And then in Deathly Hallows, they recreated that in CG and then added all of the new Deathly Hallows additions like the viaduct. So when it came to Fantastic Beasts, you know, filmmaking has kind of moved on a bit. They probably want to use a CG version of the castle rather than a model. So the only CG version they already had was the Deathly Hallows version. Now, they could have altered that. They could have made it look like a earlier version of the castle. They could have changed some things, but no. Probably because of time and money, they just flat out used the CG version of Deathly Hallows and they didn't change it at all. But what's interesting is the marketing department don't seem to know that, because in the posters for Secrets of Dumbledore, they are using a different version of the castle to the version of the castle they're using in the films. In the films, they're using the Deathly Hallows version. In the posters, they're using a Half-Blood Prince version. And the reason I know this is because the viaduct is in the pre-Deathly Hallows position in the posters. And in one poster, I really dived into this, they are using a photo of the theme park of Hogwarts. So not even using a photo from the earlier films. The designer has clearly Googled Hogwarts, found that photo, and just kind of fiddled with it a bit, put a filter on it, and then they've put that into the poster. And it's the wrong, that's not the version of the castle they're using. That's the Half-Blood Prince version in the posters, but that's not the version of the castle that's in the Fantastic Beasts films. You're using the Deathly Hallows version. The theme park version isn't even a full version of Hogwarts. It's like a glorified facade that's missing a lot of the towers. So it doesn't even make sense just to go and get a picture of that. So this is clearly just a minor error, but it just makes me laugh. Being such a Hogwarts nerd, it's immediately obvious to me when I see these posters, but I'm like, that's wrong. That's the wrong version of the castle. There's no viaduct there. Where's the viaduct? But onto the actual films themselves, the Fantastic Beasts films, Crimes of Grindelwald and Secrets of Dumbledore, where we see Hogwarts Castle. There was something that just felt a bit off about it to me. Something a bit wrong. I didn't feel as nostalgic about seeing the castle as I thought I would. Which is interesting because the marketing campaign for Secrets of Dumbledore in particular is really focusing on nostalgia. They're really like focusing on Dumbledore, even showing clips of Michael Gambon, and they are focusing on Hogwarts. Like Hogwarts and Dumbledore seem to be like the two prongs of their campaign. And they are very clearly trying to like get that nostalgia money. You know, the money that made Star Wars The Force Awakens so ridiculously successful. And they did the same thing with Crimes of Grindelwald, like they had a big shot of Hogwarts in that trailer. But yet the box office doesn't really seem to be showing that all of the Potter fans are actually coming to these films. Now part of that could be what's happening in the real world with J.K. Rowling, or it feels too soon. Maybe it's that none of the original cast are in these films. It's kind of interesting, isn't it? Like, why are these not as successful as Harry Potter? But I was kind of thinking, like, in a world where the Millennium Falcon being in a Force Awakens trailer makes everyone go insane, why is Hogwarts not having the same effect in the marketing for Fantastic Beasts, Secrets of Dumbledore? And I think it's because Hogwarts doesn't quite feel right in the promotional materials, and I'm going to dive into why I think that is. I think there's a big problem in how they're shooting the castle, both from a kind of production design kind of point of view, but also mainly in the colour grading. Now, I think what really worked about the first two Harry Potter films, the reason those films took off, is that Hogwarts felt like a warm, cosy, inviting place to go to. There was something about the way they had shot that castle that made it feel magical and warm and inviting. Another thing I think that proves that is that you can see really popular videos on YouTube which are like Hogwarts ambience. You know, it's like a 3-hour video of like Great Hall ambience. I think what that is indicative of is this feeling that people just want to spend time in that world. But I think they specifically want to spend time in the Philosopher's Stone and Chamber of Secrets era of the castle. And there's a reason for that, and I think a lot of it is down to the colour grading. Because the colour grading in the first couple of films makes Hogwarts feel really, really warm. There's a kind of thing in colour correction, and I'm not the biggest expert on this, but there's a thing in colour correction where you have a temperature bar, and it's literally a bar that goes from orange to blue. Because generally, if you see something that looks more blue, you think that's cold. And if you see something that looks more orange, you think that's warm. And you can use this bar to kind of change the kind of temperature of your shot. Now in Philosopher's Stone there's a very clear contrast in the colours that are used for the Muggle world and the Wizarding world. So in particular you can see this in the scene where Harry first goes past 9¾. The way they shoot the Muggle world is very, very different to the way they shoot the Wizarding world. And most of it is just down to that colour grading, I think. It looks much warmer in the Wizarding world. I think there's a general feeling of like, if something looks warmer, it makes you think of like a room with a nice open fire in it. You know, you just want to sit in there and relax. And all those little tricks with colour and set design make you want to go to Hogwarts in those first couple of films. I think it tails off towards the rest of the films. I think as the films go on, the version of Hogwarts we see becomes bleaker and bleaker and bleaker, and that is reflected in the colour palette. Because as they go on, the films definitely get more desaturated to the point where Deathly Hallows is like grey and blue. It's like very desaturated, that film. And what's annoying is Fantastic Beasts is carried on with that kind of duller, more desaturated colour palette from the later end of the Harry Potter films. And I think that's probably because they have the same director as Order of the Phoenix onwards directing the Fantastic Beasts movies. So it kind of makes sense that the visual style is very similar. But it's just a shame that they've stuck with that colour palette because it makes the whole thing look so dull and uninviting. And in particular, I feel like this is noticeable with the Hogwarts shots in the Secrets of Dumbledore promotional materials. For example, you can see this really clearly with the Grey Hall. Just take a look at a comparison here of the version of the Grey Hall we see in Philosopher's Stone compared to Fantastic Beasts, Secrets of Dumbledore. It looks so much more warm and vibrant in Philosopher's Stone than it does in Fantastic Beasts. Now we'll get onto the colour grading in a second, but just look at the production design as well. The candles feel really present, the fires are lit, it just makes the whole thing just feel really inviting in a place you want to go to. Whereas in Fantastic Beasts it just looks so dull and grey and lifeless. And it's like, how have you got this so wrong? I think part of it is they're trying to make these films kind of serious, like dark, serious kind of films about wars. So they want to make the visual style of the film reflect that. But why not have Hogwarts as a bright, shining contrast to the darker aspects of the Wizarding World? Wouldn't that kind of represent something? You know, you can show that there's something worth fighting for, something worth saving. There's nice parts of the Wizarding World that feel really warm and nice and cozy that you want to protect. Why does everything have to feel like it's painted with the same kind of dark, grim brush? And the colour grading in particular, it's so, so desaturated in Fantastic Beasts. And to prove this, I've done a little bit of colour grading myself, just try and like show the difference. Now, I'm not the best colour grader. It's not something I'm particularly good at. I don't really have a good eye for it. But with these shots in particular, it's so easy just to improve them a little bit. So these are some shots that I've colour corrected myself. I've basically just kind of made them warmer. I've turned up the exposure a little bit. I've kind of brought out the highlights a bit more. It's very subtle stuff, but it does make the shots look a little bit more inviting, I think. There's a really big YouTube channel which I really like called Red Letter Media, and one of their kind of sayings is, you may not have noticed it, but your brain did. I think there's a lot of that going on. There's just something about the way they present Hogwarts in these films that just doesn't hit you in the same way as it did in the earlier Harry Potter films. And it's little subtle things like the colour and the production design that are affecting that. Now I will give props for the flashback scenes in Crimes of Grindelwald of Hogwarts. the castle looked brighter in those. You know, they were clearly shooting more on location. They had a lot more natural lighting in them, which just kind of improved the colours a little bit. So I will say that, yeah, the flashback scenes in that film were a bit better. But the other scenes, no, still quite a dull version. So I think this is partly why we're not seeing the nostalgia aspect of the marketing translate into box office results. Now, at this current time, Secrets of Dumbledore hasn't been released in the UK yet. I think it's going to be released on Thursday night. I'm not even sure if I'm going to go at this point. I mean, I probably will. There's been controversy after controversy with these films, to the point where I now think of it as Harry Potter and the Cursed franchise. I think the problem with all of that stuff is that the actual core Harry Potter fandom, I think, is quite welcoming and nice and kind of progressive. And some of those issues are things that go against that. So I think there will be quite a significant proportion of Harry Potter fans which won't go out and see this, which is kind of weird, because I think the normies, like the more mainstream kind of people that don't really like go on Twitter a lot and stuff, so, you know, they don't really know about this situation with Johnny Depp and Amber Heard. And there are people like that, like my siblings probably don't know anything about that, or my parents definitely don't. I think all of those kind of normies, they won't care. They'll go and see it. Whereas the core audience, some of them, will be lost. So it's going to be interesting to see how Secrets of Dumbledore is actually going to do. To begin with, I'd just like to say thank you to everyone who subscribed since the Hogwarts Legacy video. The response on that was just amazing. Like, as a small YouTuber that, you know, I started this channel during lockdown and I haven't really known what to do with it. It's been really, like, nice to see the response from that. So, yeah, thank you for subscribing, and I hope you stick around. But I do just want to address some of the comments that were left on that video, and specifically to all the people that were doubting my Hogwarts expert credentials. The whole video is meant to be a parody of the Variety Fair videos, where they will get, like, a history expert reacts to scenes in war films. And, yeah, people just took it very, like, literally. Like, thinking that I get paid to tour universities talking about Hogwarts. I have made the castle in two separate video games and made several videos like this talking about it, so I do know what I'm talking about, but I am mainly an expert on the film version of the castle. Also, a lot of people kind of took it as me being critical of the game version of the castle when I said that, you know, a particular room wasn't very accurate to the films. And that's just not the case. I just kind of thought it'd be fun to do a comparison between the two. I'm actually really, really happy and excited to see where that game is going. But yeah, thank you for watching this video. It was very long-winded, but I hope you enjoyed it. Going forward, if you are a fan of the Hogwarts Legacy game, I will definitely be doing more content about that. As their kind of like new footage gets released, I will do kind of new reactions to it. So there might be a Fantastic Beasts Secrets of Dumbledore review in the next kind of 2 weeks, but at the same time, I might not. I don't know. Let's see how it goes. I might also try and get my friend involved who did the previous Fantastic Beasts review of me. But yeah, we'll see how it goes. Apart from that, I don't know. This kind of channel started as kind of like a Sims channel, and all the Hogwarts stuff has like taken off way more than the Sims stuff. And like, I do really enjoy talking about Hogwarts, but like, can you make a whole YouTube channel just about Hogwarts? Maybe. Maybe that's what it will become. We'll see. But yeah, thank you for watching this, and stick around for more content like this coming soon. Cheers.